If I ask you to tell me, where is the key technology that most likely will shape the nearby future and influence our lives coming from? What would you answer? What comes to your mind? Of course, your brain will instantly think about Silicon Valley, where most of the tech juggernauts are settled, like Apple, Facebook, and Google. Probably others would swap that option for China's equivalent in Shenzhen, home to the most brilliant minds in the country dedicated to developing cutting-edge innovation in AI, robotics, and software. Unlike you, my mind went neither way, and by the end of this video, it's highly unlikely you will come up with the same answer if somebody ever asked you the same question again. Here you will understand why a company from the Netherlands is indeed the most important, but especially decisive, tech company with a power big enough to create an entire trade war between China and the United States. Today, I introduce you to ASML, the leading semiconductor machinery maker and Europe's hidden gem. I am planning on making more videos talking about companies or stocks, so if you appreciate the content or want to see a video covering a specific company or stock, let me know down in the comments, and as always, very much appreciated if you can like this video to support the channel. Semiconductors are today possibly receiving the most attention ever, whether because of shortages, supply chain issues, or trade wars. In the financial spectrum, semiconductor stocks have been for the last decade some of the most traded and hottest names in the financial industry. Players like AMD, Nvidia, or Broadcom are some of those semiconductor giants which not only attracted attention from crowds of retail investors, but also delivered stellar gains resembling the best of the times during the early 2000s dot-com bubble. Hopefully, these companies are today much better positioned, profitable, with robust business models and wide portfolios of cutting-edge products. Semiconductors today, unlike in the 90s, are present in almost every product we use. Progressively, we have been able to incorporate them into things we had always used before without them, like coffee machines, cars, or fridges, to name a few. One of the most remarkable contributors to innovation in the semiconductor industry was Mr. Gordon Moore, co-founder of America's largest semiconductor company, Intel, and better known for establishing the principles of Moore's Law. A semiconductor is nothing else than a tiny metallic chip which, as its own name indicates, helps conduct electric impulses from one chip to another. In this process, the semiconductor is used as an information transmission channel. It can be programmed to react to heat, to store memory, to accelerate the rate of information, or to execute a predefined command. It's really hard to define which was the first semiconductor to ever be created. The light bulb, invented by Thomas Edison, could very well be considered some type of semiconductor. The invention of the transistor, the diode, or Intel's first 4004, the world's first single-chip microprocessor, can be also considered as key milestones for the evolution of the industry. Here is when we bring back Moore's Law. The only reason semiconductors have evolved so much and penetrated in every aspect of our lives is because we have managed to decrease their size and cost. We have been able to make them smaller while keeping the features we require from them, allowing us to put more transistors in the same space as before. With more transistors in the same space, we increase the number of commands, reactions, and speed the chip is able to deliver. Mr. Moore coined the law after observing that on average, every 18 months, the advances in technology, new materials, and innovation managed to double the integration rate. Or in other words, every 18 months, the amount of transistors per microchip doubled. Moore's law, although it's not a real law but an observation, has held up pretty well over the years, and it's still considered a good reference to measure semiconductor innovation rates. Thanks to this process of improving semiconductor efficiency, engineers have managed to create new life-changing products hard to even imagine, like the smartphone or the tablet. It wouldn't be a bold call to state semiconductor innovation is responsible for the last 60 years of development. But as Tesla's Elon Musk says,
we've realized that the true problem, the true difficulty, and where the greatest potential is building the machine that makes the machine. In other words, building the factory. And really thinking of the factory like a product.
In 1984, Dutch electronics giant Philips and semiconductor supplier Advanced Semiconductor Materials created a new company called ASM Lithography, which was headquartered in Eindhoven. Just as Elon Musk, they realized the great opportunity to develop the machine which makes the machine in the semiconductor industry. Lithographic machines are the machines which make semiconductors, but not just one, two, three of them, but billions. When ASML cascaded capital on R&D for lithographic machines, the market was dominated by the unstoppable Japanese firms like Canon and Nikon, which today still are the competitors. ASML didn't grow very fast at first, as it faced reluctancy from customers and R&D investments took so much time to deliver the first cutting-edge product to generate income that the company saw itself on the brink of bankruptcy during the start of the 90s. The trust placed by new customers and the success of its first innovative solutions helped the company attract the attention of Wall Street, and by 1995, it launched an IPO to become publicly traded in the Amsterdam and New York stock exchanges. The new influx of cash was a massive cushion for the company, which would use to fuel further growth. The semiconductor industry is one of the most cyclical businesses, and this represents both risks and opportunities. When new technology delivers new products, or those new products become substitutes for previous ones, the demand for certain types of semiconductors grows, while demand for other types of semiconductors fades. ASML focused on building better lithography machines, those which later would be bought by companies seeking to produce chips at large scales, also known as foundries. The biggest foundry in the world is located in Taiwan and belongs to the Taiwanese firm TSMC, while the second belongs to Samsung in South Korea. ASML's success is directly related to the rise of TSMC and Samsung. The business model of the foundry was inexistent before the 90s. The leading chip manufacturers like Intel didn't only happen to be involved in the manufacturing process, but designing, packing, and coding the software too, literally everywhere. Both TSMC and ASML took the opposite path and delivered a competitive advantage. While TSMC focused on becoming the top foundry in the world, producing chips for all customers with the highest quality standards and competitive prices, ASML focused on developing the most advanced lithographic machines, those able to produce more chips, smaller chips, and cheaper chips. And they succeeded. Today, ASML owns a monopoly in the EUV machine market. EUV is the only machine currently in existence able to produce the smallest and most advanced types of semiconductors, the 5nm chips. No other company produces equipment advanced enough to produce 5nm chips, and inside the entire lithographic machines market, they own a market share of around 62%, being their most loyal customers those who produce 90% of the supply of chips. TSMC, Samsung, and Intel. This makes ASML a virtual monopoly in the lithographic machines market, which hasn't gone unnoticed by investors who have pushed the market capitalization of the company well beyond $200 billion. As of the time of this video, making it the fourth largest semiconductor company in the world by market cap. In 2021, ASML generated €18.6 billion in sales, €5.6 billion in net income, with a 36.1% net income margin. That situates ASML as the 8th most profitable semiconductor company. But its market cap is the 4th largest, which very well could mean, assuming current prices efficiently reflect the present value of future cash flows to equity, that investors expect ASML to advance positions in the ladder of profitability. Considering they are effectively a monopoly, they are very well positioned to achieve that. And the conditions which helped ASML become what it is today are still in place. Capitalism is generally successful when a list of conditions are set in place to create favorable business environments and economic growth. In some way, looking back to the history of ASML, it can be considered the biggest success within the European Union. Since the implementation of the Treaty of Maastricht, which abolished borders inside member states, and the introduction of the euro, no other company inside the European Union has flourished like ASML has. The Netherlands is a remarkably stable economy, shares borders with the two largest economies in the European Union, and has one of the world's best education systems, with some of the top universities in engineering and science. The burst of the Japanese bubble at the end of the 80s, the Asian currency crisis from the 90s, and the slowdown of the Japanese economy inflicted serious hardship to Japanese leaders and competitors. Not only the time and situation could not have been better, but management decisions to expand into the US by acquisitions of leading semiconductor designers, machine manufacturers, and optimizers proved to be the big deal. Probably, the management board didn't envisage how successful this strategy would be for the future. ASML not only acquired semiconductor companies, it also happened to build the most complex, efficient, and valuable semiconductor supply chain in the world, which is the reason why they don't have any competition today. Many companies rely on ASML just as much as ASML relies on them. In the same way, almost no players from abroad dare to adventure themselves to threaten the dominance of Airbus and Boeing. Not many projects dare to threaten ASML's lead. The size of the initial investment and building from scratch a comparable supply chain of the most sought after, expensive and scarce cutting-edge technology, while all the key clients and closely tied to your competitor, makes the bet so risky, almost nobody presents a challenge. It's even hard to imagine how a new company could deliver a machine to the market sufficiently better than ASML's without the backup from the best suppliers. And if they could, would the price tag be competitive enough to steal customers and break decades-long partnerships of success with the Asian juggernauts? Highly unlikely. I really hope I've managed to explain clearly enough why ASML is so important to the world economy. Without them, we would not have the machines enabling us to scale production of the most innovative technology we're able to discover. They have the power to decide who will they sell their machines to and how many of them. Hence, the future of the tech war between the East and the West can be decided by a company you rarely hear of coming from the Netherlands. ASML is today's Europe crown jewel, and probably would continue to be so for at least the next decade. But if one lesson can be learned from the semiconductor history, is that sometimes innovation knocks at your door very fast. In the semiconductor industry, every 18 months on average. We finally reached the end of the video. I hope you liked it, enjoy it, and please remember to leave a like or your thoughts and feelings about ASML, and see you in the next one.